This is Zen 5, in all of its glory and with never seen before detail. Once again, Fritzchen's Fritz made the invisible visible and delivered ultra high resolution die shots of a Ryzen 9000 Zen 5 CPU. In this video, we will go on a chip deep dive into the silicon heart of AMD's Zen 5. We will analyze both the I/O die and the core complex die and compare them to the previous Zen 4 generation to see what has changed and what stayed the same. Without spoiling anything, in many ways Zen 5 is radically different and even holds some mysteries that I can't fully explain, especially in regards to the upcoming 3D V-cache enabled X3D CPUs. I've put chapters into the video timeline below so you can easily find the sections you are most interested in. Without further ado, let's uncover the silicon secrets of Zen 5. And remember, all the images you see in this video are real pictures. Underneath the heat spreader, we encounter the classic Ryzen chiplet layout, which hasn't changed since the introduction of Zen 2 in 2019. In the center, we can see the large I/O die, which, as the name implies, handles all the input and output of the CPU. The CPU chiplet, also called Core Complex Die or CCD, is located right below. Since we are looking at a Ryzen 5 9600X, there's only a single CCD. Ryzen CPUs with more than 8 cores include a second CCD in the empty space next to it. In comparison, Zen 4 and Zen 5 look very similar, but there are some differences that are visible even to the naked eye. The most obvious one is the shape of the CCD. While the Zen 4 CCD has a rectangular shape, Zen 5 looks almost square. We can also spot a few more capacitors on the PCB. Interestingly, even though the CCDs have different shapes, they are almost exactly the same size. Zen 4 clocks in at 69.435 square millimeters and Zen 5 at 69.973 square millimeters. I'd call that margin of error. The impressive part is that AMD managed to pack a lot more transistors into the same chip size. The Zen 5 CCD contains 8.315 billion transistors, a 26.6 increase over the 6.57 billion in Zen 4. As a result, Zen 5 has a transistor density of 118.8 million transistors per square millimeters, compared to only 94.6 million on Zen 4. That's a much larger increase than the 6% density uplift TSMC claims with N4P over N5P. Something is going on here. But before we dive deeper into the Zen 5 CCD, let's take a quick look at the I/O die. At 121 square millimeters, the I/O die is quite a bit larger than the CCD, but it only contains 3.4 billion transistors. This results in a relatively low transistor density of 28.1 million transistors per square millimeter. And while this is in part because of the less dense N6 process node, the main culprit is that analog and interconnect circuitry doesn't scale well with modern process nodes. These types of transistors just don't get really smaller anymore. The older process node is used because a modern one wouldn't provide any tangible density benefits, but increase the cost of production. Looking at the die shot, we can see that it's packed with all your interconnect needs. On the left, we can locate the physical layer of the memory interface. Zen 5 supports dual-channel DDR5, and we can see 4 clusters with 40 bits each. That's 32 bits for the DDR5 and an additional 8 bit for ECC functionality. In total, the I/O die provides a 160-bit wide interface. The memory controllers are located right next to the physical layer. If we stay at the edges of the chip, we can locate some general I/O SerDes on the bottom left. With input from Nemes, who goes under the handle GPUs are matching on Twitter, we can even label the individual ports. The small ones are USB 2 ports, which haven't changed since the original Zen design. Interestingly, USB 3 and DisplayPort are often combined into a single cluster. To the right of the general I/O, we can find 28 PCI Express 5.0 SerDes. These are the lanes used to connect the CPU to GPUs and PCIe SSDs. On the top of the chip, bordering the memory interface, there's a very special area. These are the Infinity Fabric interconnects that are used to communicate with the CCDs. In theory, each CCD should contain similar structures. Let's keep that in mind for later. The large cluster in the center of the I/O die is the Ardennais 2-based iGPU, which was introduced with Zen 4. It contains 2 compute units, which is the lowest possible number because the Ardennais 2 architecture is based on so-called workgroup processors or WGPs, and a single WGP contains 2 compute units. It's a full Ardennais 2 workgroup with 128 ALUs and ray tracing support. As usual, the GPU miscomplex is a lot bigger than the compute units itself. Aside from the GPU, we can locate two more clusters, the display engine right next to the memory interface and the video DN encoder to the right of the GPU. After talking to a couple of people, there are different opinions on which cluster is which. I've marked them the way that makes the most sense to me, but it's a good reminder that some areas of silicon analysis are more based on educated guesses. The still unmarked areas of the I/O die are used for power management, audio processing, PCI Express control, and other MISC and interconnect areas. It's almost impossible to accurately label all areas without the guidance of an AMD engineer. So what has changed compared to Zen 4? Well, nothing. The Zen 5 I/O die is exactly the same as the one used in Zen 4. If you compare them with a die chart overlay, we can see that they are identical. And it does make sense. Zen 4 already provided enough state-of-the-art I/O. No reason to spend money and engineering time creating a new I/O die when the one you already have works fine. AMD did the same with Zen 2 and Zen 3, where they reused the same I/O die for two CPU generations. Now that we have analyzed the I/O die, let's tackle the more interesting of the two chiplets. The Zen 5 CCD. And wow, what a sight. The die shot is a composite image of thousands of individual pictures. The final image has a size of 1.6 GB and shows Zen 5 in incredible detail. Fritzchen's Fritz has outdone himself once again. At this point, I'd also like to thank each of my Patreon supporters. You might not be many, but your contributions help buy the very CPU that was used for these pictures. You deserve some praise for that. And if you aren't a Patreon, simply liking the video and subscribing to the channel helps a lot. At first glance, we can once again see the almost square nature of the Zen 5 CCD. The first distinction we can make is the large unified CCX that covers most of the chip and some structures below it. Remember the Infinity Fabric interconnects on the I/O die? The same exact layout is visible on the bottom right of the CCD. These are the counterparts to the interconnects we've seen before, and they are used to connect the CCD with the I/O die. That means, for example, if the CPU wants to access the memory, it has to go through the Infinity Fabric interconnects and the I/O die first, because that's where the memory interface and controllers are located. That's why Zen doesn't have the best memory latency and loves on-die cache. To the left of the Infinity Fabric, we can see an area that's used for the system management unit and other MISC capabilities. The CCX itself is split up into two distinct parts, a large unified L3 cache in the center surrounded by 8 individual Zen 5 CPU cores. One of the first things I noticed when I saw this Zen 5 die shot was the much more compact L3 cache area. This is immediately obvious when we compare it to Zen 4. On Zen 4, the L3 cache area takes up a total of 24 square millimeters, while the L3 cache on Zen 5 only uses 15.7 square millimeters. Remember, both have basically the same die size. This difference is even more striking when we look at the percentages. On Zen 4, the L3 cache area takes up 34.6% of the entire die. That's more than a third. On Zen 5, the L3 cache only uses 22.4% of the chip, so less than a quarter. That's a massive reduction. Both chips provide the same 32 megabytes of L3 cache and are manufactured in a very similar 5 nanometer class process node. And SRAM doesn't scale with new process nodes anyways. To double check, I even went ahead and counted the L3 cache cells. The ultra high resolution of the die shots made it possible. It allows us to see the individual 4 kilobyte SRAM rows of each 64 kilobyte block. And it's true, Zen 5 does still have 32 megabytes L3 cache. So how did AMD achieve such a massive reduction in L3 cache area? AMD achieved it not by shrinking the individual cache cells, which stayed very similar in size, but by packing them much more tightly. If we look at a Zen 4 die shot, we can see large gaps in between the cache cells. There are three large rows interrupting the cache blocks on Zen 4, and the same is true for Zen 3. The row in the middle is filled with larger logic blocks, and the two rows to the left and right are filled with TSVs, so-called through-silicon vias, the interconnects for the 3D V-cache chiplet. On Zen 5, the middle row is almost non-existent. In most parts, it's not much wider than the gaps between the cache cells themselves. And while the two rows to the left and right still exist, they are now much more narrow than before. The reduction and outright elimination of these gaps within the L3 cache area allowed AMD to pack the L3 cache much more tightly. This isn't just a small redesign. Such a major overhaul has to be planned from the ground up. My guess would that be until Zen 4, AMD carried over some design baggage from back when Zen was still split up into 4 core CCX clusters. AMD unified the CCX with Zen 3, but it seems like this wasn't a ground up redesign, but more of a quick fix. Designing a new L3 cache area from zero resulted in a much higher density. Pretty amazing if you ask me. But what about the TSVs? As just mentioned, some of the gaps in the L3 cache were used for special interconnects called through-silicon vias that allow the 3D vCache chiplet to interface with the CCD. For its X3D CPUs, AMD is using a 3D packaging technology from TSMC called System on Integrated Chips, or SoIC for short. SoIC is using so-called hybrid wafer bonding, where two chips are directly stacked on top of each other and results in very dense and ultra-short connections, perfect to expand the L3 cache. Here's how it works. Both chips have the same tiny TSV copper pads. The chips are then placed on top of each other so that the TSV pads on each chip align. This chip stack is then slowly heated, which causes the copper to expand and form a connection. Nothing else is needed, as the TSV bonds fuse the two chips together. It's a very sophisticated but also fragile process. So, does Zen 5 still have TSVs? That's actually a very good question, and it wasn't as easy to answer as I expected. When screening the die shot for the first time, I couldn't spot any TSVs. On Zen 3, it's hard to miss them, even with the naked eye. With AMD's first 3D vCache generation, there are two types of TSVs that are easy to distinguish. One for data and one for power. The data TSVs come with a small I/O circuit. The power TSVs are just tiny connection points. Hans de Vries created a pretty good visual explanation, and Nemes, aka GPUs Are Magic, went the extra mile and counted them. All 24,070 of them. Zen 4 changed the TSVs a bit, but not by much. The data TSVs are still contained in two large rows, and the power TSVs are the tiny dots spread all throughout the L3 cache area. Because the Zen 4 CCD was smaller than the Zen 3 CCD, while the cache chiplet didn't shrink in size, some of the power TSVs were also placed inside the L2 cache of the CPU cores, because the cache chiplet now covered a larger area of the base CCD. In simple words, the bottom chip got smaller while the top chip stayed the same size, so it covered more area of the bottom chip. And that's what I expected for Zen 5, that the cache chiplet would cover an even larger area. But I couldn't spot the TSVs. Not in the two rows inside the L3 cache, not between the L3 cache blocks, and not inside the L2 cache. What's going on here? Well, I wasn't looking hard enough. On Zen 5, the TSVs have seen a massive change compared to previous generations. First of all, they are still inside the two rows, within the L3 cache. But that's the only place they are, aside from a handful just above the Infinity Fabric. The reason I initially had troubles finding them is because they are now much smaller and there are a lot less of them. Thankfully, the image from Fritzchen's Fritz are so high res that even the TSVs can be seen if you know what to look for. It's the super tiny structures inside the rows. Some of them have what seems like a black spot, others don't. This might be the difference between the data and power TSVs, but it's hard to say. In total, Zen 5 seems to have around 9,000 of these new TSVs, a massive reduction from the 24,000 found on Zen 3. Zen 4 did reduce this TSV count a bit, but nowhere close to that. The best way to understand how massive this change really is by looking at die shots. On Zen 3 and Zen 4, the TSV data rows are clearly visible, even without zooming in. On Zen 5, the TSVs are so tiny that they are hard to spot, even when zoomed in. Once we knew where the TSVs were located, Fritzchen was able to get more detailed images, including some measurements. Here we can see the TSVs on a Zen 4 CCD. The data TSVs come with a small I/O circuit attached and are around 10 by 10 micrometers in size. The power TSVs are smaller at 5 by 5 micrometers. Even though these structures are tiny, they are clearly visible on this image. On Zen 5, the TSV measures between 3 by 3 and 3 by 4 micrometers, and it looks like the data TSVs don't come with an attached I/O circuit anymore. This isn't just a simple size reduction. The TSVs on Zen 5 are radically different compared to the ones found on Zen 3 and Zen 4. And since there are always two parts to the puzzle, namely the 3D vCache chiplet, we can assume that the cache chiplet has the same changes. But what does that mean for the physical implementation of the 3D vCache chiplet? Let's take a look at the Zen 4 implementation first to weigh the options. In this comparison, you can see a normal Zen 4 CCD on top and a 7800X2D on bottom. The visual difference is the cache chiplet on the 7800X2D, which covers the L3 cache and L2 cache area on the bottom die. The cache chiplet has a more dense layout. It contains 64 MB of L3 cache, twice the amount of the CCD. If we take this very same cache chiplet and place it on Zen 5, it would cover much more than just the L3 and L2 cache area, because the L3 cache on the Zen 5 CCD is much more compact. In fact, placing the Zen 4 cache chiplet on Zen 5 would cover more than 50% of the integer units inside the CPU cores. That's not good for heat dissipation. If you go ahead and assume the new 3D V-cache chiplet is just double the L3 cache area on the Zen 5 CCD, the cache chiplet would still fully cover the L2 cache and reach far into the integer area of the cores. Yes, the 3D V-cache chiplet uses a more cache-optimized process node than the CCD and it doesn't contain cache control areas, so in reality it would be smaller than our example here. But even with these optimizations, I can see the new cache chiplet going back to only covering the L3 cache area, which is strange because the TSVs can only be found inside the two rows in the middle of the L3 cache. There are no power TSVs spread out over the other areas, which is what I would have expected. It's also strange from a structural point of view, since the TSVs are what keeps the two chiplets glued together. If the cache chiplet covers a large area, but is only fused together in two small rows in the center, it could negatively impact its stability. Another much more exciting option would be a double-stacked, two-high 3D V-cache chiplet. SOIC has the capability and it would offer an explanation why the TSVs are only inside the L3 cache and why there are so few of them. But double stacking the cache chiplets introduces other drawbacks and is a more expensive and fragile process. In the end, we have to wait and see to know for sure. A single 3D V-cache chiplet is still the most likely version, and I'm curious to see how AMD managed it with so little TSVs. Maybe the answer is that we missed something on the die shot. But it would be a lie if I said a double stack 3D V-cache chiplet wouldn't be the most exciting answer to this TSV mystery. Now that we've analyzed the L3 cache and TSVs in great detail, let's take a look at the Zen 5 CPU cores. Each core is made up of three parts: the core exclusive L2 cache, the integer unit, and the floating point unit. The L2 cache is located right next to the L3 cache and also connects the cores with the ring bus. The 1 MB L2 cache is divided into two 512 KB cache blocks with the L2 cache tags and the control in the middle. The L2 cache has a slightly different structure than the L3 cache, with 2 KB rows instead of 4 KB rows, and also uses a bit more area per kilobyte. On the bottom, we can see another area. That's where on previous Zen iterations, we could find the chip pervasive logic, or CPL, which is how I've marked it here, although this is more of an educated guess. Right next to the L2 cache area and taking up the most amount of space of the CPU core is the integer unit. And it's here where I've reached my limit. Zen 5 has changed enough compared to Zen 4 and Zen 3 that the individual areas are difficult to label. Zen 5 is a much wider design. We can spot areas with lots of cache, which most likely are the L1 instruction and data cache, the ops cache, and the branch prediction unit. But I don't feel comfortable enough to label them on that level. Luckily, the floating point unit is much simpler to label, even though it also has seen a lot of change. Zen 5 now supports full rate AVX 512, and we can see two 256-bit units side by side. The FPU scheduler is located in the middle, next to the execution units and the registers. On previous Zen generations, that's also where we would find the microcode ROM, but I can't spot that on Zen 5. With previous Zen cores, it would have been easy to label all the different areas of the core. And while we are in a good spot, L2 cache and FPU are mapped out, the integer core still holds some mysteries, which I'm sure will be solved once FritzchenFritz publishes the die shots and smarter people than me take a look at the cores. Zooming out, we can see Zen 5 once more in all of its glory. AMD didn't lie when they said Zen 5 will be a ground-up new design. On the silicon level, Zen 5 is vastly different compared to previous generations. The most obvious tell is the almost square layout of the CCD. On Zen 4, a FPU and integer unit of a single core use 3.9% of the total die area. With Zen 5, that increases to 5.3%. Zen 5 is a much beefier and wider design, creating a suitable base for future generations. The FPU has basically been doubled, the integer core was redesigned, and the L3 cache has seen an overhaul. It's insane how much further AMD was able to optimize the next generation TSVs, which is also the part I'm most excited about. How will AMD implement the new 3D V-cache? Why are there only so few TSVs? Did I miss something? Or could we even see a double stack cache chiplet? And while I know that it's not very likely, technological advances like that are what makes me excited about the future of semiconductors. I would like to know what surprised you the most about Zen 5. And of course, your opinion on the TSV mystery. Do you think I've missed something? Will the new 3D V-cache chiplet cover more areas of the CPU cores? Or do you believe we could actually see a double stack solution? Let me know in the comments down below. Again, many thanks to the amazing work of FritzchenFritz, without whom we wouldn't be able to get these exclusive insights into Zen 5. He should release the high-res images shortly after this video. I've linked his Flickr in the description below. go check him out. I hope you found this video interesting and see you in the next one.